So I don't know about you, but I'm excited to see the fate of the Furious. But I'm also excited to see the eighth movie in this franchise. Welcome to a Midnight Review. I'm Carson, your bespectacled host. This is my co-host, Savannah, also with the spectacles, but whatever. Yeah, once again, not midnight, but when you're given an opportunity to see a movie like this at 7 p.m. instead of having to be here at midnight, get out of the movie at 3 and then still have to go to work on Friday, well, you kind of tend to take that opportunity. So here we are, about 7 o'clock, about ready to go see the eighth movie in this franchise. And I don't know about you, but I am super excited for this.
Yeah, I'm pretty stoked too.
Are you? You say that like I should match your energy, but I'm not really stoked.
I like watched them all yesterday. So.
Okay. So let me explain a little bit about this. I've seen the first one a few times, the second one way too much as a kid. My dad loved the movie, so we watched a bunch. The third one I've seen a handful of times. The fourth one I've seen a few times. Five I've only watched through a couple of times, not for it being bad. I legitimately like it. I just haven't seen it that many times. Six I absolutely love. Seven was incredible. And eight, I'm just like, yes, keep going. Like, I don't... Have you seen the trailer for this?
Yes, I
mean,
I have.
Ludacris is like, it's about to get lit, and for the next 3 minutes, it's the most lit thing you've ever seen. They got giant wrecking balls, like, wrecking cars and my shit. They have, like, they have The Rock just going, I'm gonna beat you like a Cherokee drum. I don't even know what that means, but I'm in. I am in like Flynn for this.
I can't match that. I cannot match that enthusiasm.
So I'm at like a 10 for enthusiasm, and you're just like a, yeah, it looks fine. I think it looks pretty.
No.
So, okay. So what is your history with the franchise?
I watched it all yesterday.
Like 1 through 7 yesterday.
I didn't watch 7, and not a lot of 6.
6 and 7 are like my favorite ones.
What?
6 ends on a runway that's like a million miles long. Like a plane is trying to take off. Spoilers for 6, by the way. Plane is trying to take off, and like the whole crew is like, we can't let this plane take off. So they like shoot it with harpoons and is like trying to slow it down and trying to like weigh it down so much that it won't take off. And like, that's the last 30 minutes of the movie.
Oh
so it's
God.
Like, this runway has to be at least 1,000 miles long.
probably. Theoretically.
Okay. Anyway, I'm excited for this ridiculousness. You're excited for this ridiculousness. I mean, it has to deliver. Like, the one big thing that I am anticipating before we go and see this is the fact that I kind of feel like if this franchise wants to continue being awesome, they need to start doing the whole Mission Impossible formula, where like with every new installment, they have a new director who comes in. Because 4, 5, and 6 were all one guy, and he did great. I forget his name, but he did great with the series. Then James Wan came in with 7, and like his visual style in some of the scenes was great. I really liked it. And I think this latest one is F. Gary Gray, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, he did Straight Outta Compton. Yeah, which I liked. And then also Friday, but
he's more known for Compton.
I feel like he also did The Italian Job, the remake, which oddly enough makes him perfect for this. But anyway, I'm excited. I really hope that as this franchise continues, we get more directors who like put their vision onto this franchise.
I heard this was the last one.
No. They make too much money. Didn't you hear the writer has come out and like, we haven't ruled out space yet. Just by the way.
Is
and I'm like,
serious?
Please. Please. Yeah. Yeah. Anyway. Alright, so we're gonna go watch the movie. See you after the break.
Dominic Toretto just went rogue.
You gonna turn your back on family? miles away.
Holy!
Yeah. They just don't give up, do they?
Yeah. Oh, dang!
Fire!
So, what'd you think of it?
Honestly, I thought it was a little cheesy.
Oh! Shocker! It was cheesy. Okay, what else?
Cringe-worthy cheesy.
Yeah, like cringe so hard you start laughing. Yeah, that's the series.
Oh,
it's almost like you haven't seen any of them.
I did, but I thought, I don't know.
All right, so yeah, sorry about that. My other camera died. So we're gonna shoot the rest of this on my iPhone. Yay. Anyway, you were saying something about the cheesiness and how cringeworthy it is.
I don't know. I just couldn't get past it. And then, never mind. That's for the spoilers, but.
There shall be. There are no spoilers in this dojo.
I can say spoilers now?
No, there are no spoilers in this dojo.
I just. The logistics of some of the things just blew my mind.
Okay, you say this as if you haven't seen any of the other Fast and Furious movies. Like, none of them are concerned with realism.
Every time, though, I'm just like, really? How does that happen?
It happens because if in this universe, if you can drive a car real good, you're a superhero.
Yeah, and that he was obviously the super villain. Did a whole, like, I'm Bane thing.
Anyway, I love the movie. This person's crazy over here. I thought the movie was aces. If you liked, you know, 4, 5, 6, 7, you're gonna like this one. I know a really big question that was kind of on a lot of people's minds was, given the fact that Paul Walker is obviously not in this one, you know, is the franchise gonna be able to carry on? And I kind of feel like it will be. It was, you did kind of, personally, I do feel like you did miss him, but it wasn't to the detriment of the movie. And they did, we won't say what it was, but they actually did a nice little nod to him in the film. I liked that a lot. But it was funny. They still had to maintain, like, their diversity quota. So they still had to bring a white guy in. Jason Statham is not the white guy who they brought in. They brought in, one of Clint Eastwood's sons, Scott Eastwood, who, it's funny because I saw him in Suicide Squad. He was awful, but everybody and everything about that movie was awful. But in this, what made him so great is everybody just consistently shat on him. Like, all the time. So, Kurt Russell is Mr. Nobody Comes Back, and they all call him Little Nobody. And it's wonderful. They all call Scott Eastwood's character Little Nobody. And it's absolutely wonderful. So, I was going to say before we exit the cinema but decided to hold it in, is that the first, like, 15 minutes of this movie is, like, a travel advertisement for Cuba.
Yeah,
really I'm just like, wow, Cuba's beautiful.
A lot of babes.
That's the typical, like, car shots of the movie they have to have.
I don't know, like, when I picture Cuba, I don't picture that, like, spring break.
Oh, yeah, not at all. What is funny about that is it feels like in every movie they keep trying, like, to minimize that, like, oh yeah, this all began with street racing. They try and minimize it as much as possible. And while this one, seven is still has the record for the shortest time in which that's accomplished, because it's one drag race and that's it. This one, it's a whole set piece that is, it's ridiculous. And ends. The whole audience the whole time was laughing at this movie. But not like a ha-ha, this is stupid, but like a ha-ha, we're getting what we paid for, what we wanted. And it ends in a spectacular finish. But I gotta say, like, I really liked all the car stunts they had in this. Like, the bit in New York City was obviously the creme de la creme of the whole movie. And it goes in a spectacular way with that. But I you know, I feel like this one really, in a lot of ways, nailed the formula. Like, it did everything that you want from a Fast and Furious movie. And then it still delivered really, really hilarious and legitimately hilarious dialogue. Not Vin Diesel can barely say words dialogue. Which, I like the man. He could easily kick the shit out of me. He also has a hard time with vowels and consonants. And his grin is the goofiest grin. I love him. I really do. But he's got a toothy grin.
Yes, he does.
I will say, so the scene where they're getting out of New York City, and or they're not getting out of New York City, where they're in New York City, in the scene where Hobbs and where The Rock and Jason Statham, the transporter, are getting out of prison, that was shot really well. Like, I was legitimately impressed with a lot of the stunt work they had. I mean, it still had a lot of cuts and everything. And it's like, okay, yeah, that's par for the course for an American action film. But the way that it was constructed, the way, like, the shots lined up. For instance, there's a scene where someone has to get from a top level to a bottom level, basically. And the way that's cut together and shown is, like, entirely coherent and looks cool. Like, it was impressive. That whole sequence was just a ton of fun. What did you like the most out of the film?
Well, you just said it. That was, like, the best part of the film.
Those two parts?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean,
I really liked the New York scene, too.
The whole New York scene. The whole part where they're in New York, it's weird. This film almost feels like it has a four-act structure.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah, you have the whole first part, and then when Dom gets... Or not Dom. Cuba. When, well, I'd say Cuba and their whole thing in Berlin is one whole thing. Everything in New York it goes for such a long time and has a very obvious, like, cut where it's like, okay, this is all our exposition stuff. So everything at their undisclosed base, and then everything up to when the action starts in New York City is like its act onto itself, where all the exposition is just used. It's thrown out. And what I will say, again, without giving anything away, I like how they didn't keep the reason why Dom is doing what he's doing a secret the whole movie. Yeah. I mean, say what you will about the secret, but I do like that it wasn't, like, it wasn't built up, because if they had gone much longer without explaining that, I would have rolled my eyes even harder.
The parts of the secrets, it's just like, what the fuck?
Well, I mean, you know how it connects back, right?
Yes, but I still have issues.
It has something to do with his past. Ooh. Okay, without giving it away, what are your issues with it, though?
Sorry, I
grabbed my phone. Weird. Anyway, that wasn't to shut Savannah up. Anyway, what was the problem that you had with it?
Just his reasoning. Like, I want to know what he saw when she was like, I have this secret. I want to know what he saw and his reasoning
picture,
behind it.
A picture in a... Like, I'll cut that out. Don't worry. I'm cutting that part out. You're going to, audience, you're going to have just heard a beep, but don't worry about it. Anyway.
No, there's no explaining. Like, I need to know.
Come on. There are ways to have explained it.
Okay. There's no to his wife. How do you explain that? Like,
well, yeah. I mean, there's two ways you can go on this. One is he wanted to make sure everybody was safe. Or he could explain to his wife what's the deal. And he decided, I'm going to become a bad guy for a while. That's one way you could read into it.
He's just like, nah, she got me. She's going to forgive me.
Huh. Yeah, I mean, the way they kind of set it up is a little hokey.
Is she like a ride or die bitch?
Well, you've seen the series. You know that's kind of the case.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I gotta say, the chemistry between the characters still works incredibly well. It's still one of the highlights of this franchise. And the thing that I find hilarious is Tyrese Gibson is regularly one of my favorite characters, but his introduction in Too Fast, Too Furious, and, like, him in that movie is irritating. Like, I cannot stand that movie for a lot of reasons, but he is one of them. But in this movie, it's like, okay, we let Tyrese Gibson have, like, just that much, and we let him go wild within, like, that much space. And it's perfect. Like, the way it's interlaced is perfect. And you know, Hobbs... I don't want to say what it is, but when they first show Hobbs in the movie, was a piece of cinematic brilliance that is worth the price of the ticket alone. It was great. I don't care. I don't care what you have to say. You'll go, oh, it's so ridiculous. But yeah, that's what made it fun.
Super ridiculous.
You go to these movies because they crank it to 11 nonstop.
I rolled my eyes way too many times. Oh,
that's what's so great about it. But yeah, what I feel like the action set pieces, they going back to that, all the car action, really, really good. But they've gotten even better at doing the, like, hand-to-hand stuff, the shooting bad guys stuff. Like, they've gotten better at that. And the thing is, in these movies, it's always been kind of an awkward balance where the fisticuffs stuff always feels like it's interrupting all the car action. But in this one, it feels like whoever was editing the film really got that mix perfect. Like, there was no point in which I'm like, okay, enough punching one another. Let's get back to the car stuff. No, it worked really well. What? It's like you have something to say. You can disagree with me
sometimes
on this show.
Sometimes it just got really cheesy with the fighting. Like,
okay.
Oh, you're going to do that, and that's completely normal. Like,
yeah.
No.
Yeah. I mean, physics doesn't exist in this universe. Physics does not exist in the Fast and Furious dojo.
Oh, I didn't realize it was a completely different universe than this one. Oh.
I swear, you keep saying you've seen this franchise, but you're acting like you've never seen this franchise.
I just want to base it in our reality.
Like, okay, well then go back to Fast and Furious, the first one, the Fast and the Furious.
Oh, you mean the ones that aren't good?
No, the Fast and the Furious is fine, but I feel like if you want to get into what this franchise is now, you can really start with 4 or 5 and then just watch them all from there. But there were a couple of things that I had a little bit of an issue with. I feel like the way that they solved the problem, trying not to spoil this, the way that they solved the problem on the plane, I felt like that was a little hokey and a little like, okay, all right. And the way that was set up wasn't the best. Like when they show that particular character going down, it's like, okay, you're shooting it from far enough away. I know that he's not actually dead.
Yeah, I thought... I don't know. I thought she would have known that because it looked like he took it, like...
Right?
Not like, she had, like, organs.
Charlize Theron has, like, the god's eye. And it's like, come on. You had to have seen that from a different angle.
Well, it's like the way he took it, too. It's like, yeah, you know, that too. For a fact, he did not take it that to a vital too. Organ. Like,
Yeah, I felt like that was a little hokey. Charlize Theron, or however you say her name, she's amazing. I love her a ton. She's great in every movie. But she wasn't given a lot to do in this one.
No, like, she wasn't.
To this day, like, Jason Statham is still the high watermark for villains in this franchise. But she did great with what she was given. She just wasn't given a lot.
I don't know. I expect more from her.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing is like, well, I expect like if you have her in your movie, you write her part really well.
You just rewrite it. You're like, okay, yeah. We got her.
We got to upgrade this. But I will say, brief aside, her next movie, Atomic Blonde, looks awesome.
Yes.
I am excited for that flick. Anyway, back to the movie at hand, The Fate of the Furious. And then the only other problem that I really had with it is it felt like there were a couple of shots in the film that the director was like, oh, this is going to be like a really great shot. And then when they got the dailies back, they're like, oh, that didn't work very well. Can't reshoot it either.
Money spent.
Yeah. Yeah. There are a couple of shots in this that it's like, yeah, that would have looked cool if you had another take or two of it. Or maybe that was the best take. The one that easily comes to mind is there's a scene where, if you've seen the trailers, you know that they're in a snowy place at one point. And the car, like, comes down the hill, hits it, and you feel like the next shot is supposed to be, like, it coming up out of the ground, like, or coming up out of the snow, and the snow is everywhere. But you just see a lot of white and, like, highlights of black that are the car, and then that's it. And it just didn't really work that well. And then it was a little bit better when the sub first came out of the water.
The next few times was overkill.
Well, I mean, the first shot was okay, but then when they took it from the side, it worked a lot better. Better than that first shot. Not great, but better than the first shot. But there were a couple of instances of that where I'm like, this is a multi-billion dollar franchise. And this film essentially has an unlimited budget to work with. Can't you do that again or something? It just felt a little cheap to me. But with all that being said, I do feel like F. Gary Gray was a great choice for the director of this. He did a fantastic job. So my final thoughts are the movie's great. It's totally worth a see on the big screen if you can. Personally, I would rank it as my favorite. I could see how others wouldn't, but it's still within like the like 5, 6, 7 set. Like it fits right in there really well. But yeah, I suggest checking it out in cinemas. How about you?
I probably wouldn't recommend this.
Really?
No,
I'm not like, I'm not like, how dare you? I'm just curious, like, explain.
It's just at a point of cheesiness where I'm just like, okay. But if you're into that and you go in expecting the cheesy, expecting the like, oh, this is just going to be about cars and cheesiness and fighting.
I think this franchise stopped being about cars a long time ago.
And weird romance things going on.
Oh, that was great. That was fantastic. I loved it.
Then this is your movie.
All right.
But
that's fair. And unfortunately, we can't end this like all the Fast and Furious movies seem to end. A barbecue and everyone like coming together. I love that that's one of the staples of this franchise. You have to end it that way, or so help you God, you fucked up. Anyway, so that's gonna do it from us. This glorious midnight review that's kind of messed up. But yeah, so check us out for more reviews. Another review actually coming up this weekend, so watch out for that. It's for Colossal, by the way. And then check out the YouTube channel, youtube.com/glassfilmshouse, Twitter at glasshousefilms, and Facebook, facebook.com/glasshousefilms. I will see you next time for Colossal. You will see Savannah and myself next time for, I don't know. All right, until next time.